You're listening to The Pivotal Leader, where modern leaders talk about the moments that shifted their organizational cultures and pivoted their teams to success. Hi, this is Gina Trimarco, Chief Results Officer of Pivot 10 Results, a strategy and training company that helps businesses shift from people problems to performance results. Each week on The Pivotal Leader, I feature inspirational leaders who know how to positively impact their customers, employees, and brand through culture building and sometimes a little bit of disruption. But before we jump in, here's a pivotal fact. Your survive versus thrive ability hinges on your investment in your employees and your customers. If you don't provide meaningful, purposeful training and growth opportunities for your employees and results for your customers, they just might leave you and head straight for your competition. One of our guests recently said to me that there's no difference between customer acquisition and employee acquisition. You need to take the extra step to attract both. What do you think? If you're looking for fresh ways to keep your stakeholders engaged, shoot me an email at gina@pivot10.com and let's talk about it. Also, we are going to be doing a monthly episode where we answer your questions about culture building, specifically around attracting top talent and customers. So send those questions on to me at gina@pivot10.com and we will answer those in a future podcast. In this episode of The Pivotal Leader, I talk to Charlie Fusco, CEO and creative mastermind of Synergixx, a full-service direct response agency. Synergixx blends traditional media with evolving media platforms to deliver industry-leading sales. The in-house media division manages more than 200 host-endorsed national radio shows, as well as traditional TV, radio, and print. With professional audio and video production services on site, Synergixx is able to offer dynamic and cost-effective infomercials, web videos, radio ads, and full-service TV production. Named a top smart CEO by Brava, top CEO under 40, and known as a major business influencer for entrepreneurs in her region, Charlie Fusco provides business coaching and advice to her growing followers on thatgirlcharlie.com, her social media channels, and her CEO Powercast radio show. Charlie is a regular LinkedIn contributor, worked as a TV host, and has authored 4 books, including her latest, Brains, Boobs, and Balls, life lessons any female entrepreneur can follow. Today, her expert staff helps her expand her own business while she expands more time consulting with businesses one-on-one on how to grow big on small budgets. So excited about this episode. So listen and learn. Hey, Charlie, welcome to the Pivotal Leader podcast today.
Thank you for having me. I'm super excited to be here. As I read your tweet and I was like, when do I get to go on that show? I never got tweeted like that before.
And can you refresh our listeners on what I tweeted you?
Well, I got all tingly because I was like, I have never, ever heard of anybody having a girl crush on me. And I'm not even sure what that means, but I was taking it for the full extent. I'm like, whatever it is, I want it. And she told everyone about it. So I had to go home and ask my kids, what did it mean?
Oh, that's awesome. You know, and I took a moment on whether or not I should tweet such a thing. And then I'm like, you know what, everything I've read about you, I think it was appropriate based on what I could tell about your persona and your personality through everything that I've read about you. Because anyone who writes a book called Brains, Boobs, and Balls, I think will be okay with me having a girl crush.
Yes, I tell people all the time that one day nobody's going to want to look at me. I will be that old. And so right now I got to take it where I can get it. So I am all about the attention.
Oh, good. Perfect. And, you know, when it comes to, I actually have other, like I call them business crushes. I've got a business crush on Marcus Lemonis, and he happened to be in our town a couple of years ago. And I found out he was shooting some of his show at a restaurant that he owns in our area. And I went to the restaurant to eat so I can meet him. And
wow.
And then told him I had, well, I don't think I told him I had a business crush on him. You know, I've got these crushes on business people because I'm all about business. And so I got a picture with him, and then I wrote a blog about my dinner with Marcus, and which got a lot of traction on LinkedIn, and a lot of connections. Actually landed me a few jobs because of that. And oh gosh, what will happen when I post this podcast with you? Oh my goodness.
Wow. Now I'm even more excited.
So I get these business crushes. I think he thought I was a little stalkerish, so I won't be stalkerish with you. I want to jump right into the culture topic. We started to talk about that a little bit before we started recording. And
yes.
And I want to get your perspective on how you define culture in your own organization.
Well, what I will tell you is that it's a really important question, this idea of culture. And you've heard about the big boys, you know, what's the culture like at Google? And if you envision it, is everyone riding around on bicycles and getting free cups of coffee and having, you know, sleep napping beds, pods? You've heard about Tony over at Zappos and this culture of just make the customer happy and everything's free. And I think it's really easy to fall in love with some of these big, big ideas of culture. But what I've found is that whenever I've tried to mastermind or create a culture in my company, it's always come across as unauthentic. What we do, we certainly have a culture here, is I looked around and I said, I don't want to force fun at the office, and I don't want to force a certain way of doing things. How can I best do that? And so what we do here at the office is we have this sort of fly by the seat of our pants kind of culture. it's really kind of funny because the way that we treat our clients is very much client first, client centric. What do you need and how do we create opportunity for you? And so if you were to ask our employees here, those two questions are always coming up. What do you need today is something that we ask each other. We are certainly in tune with our employees. What do you need to be more happy, more productive, more stress-free? And how can we create opportunity for you, for your clients, for you, for your family? And so when you come into our office, it is a little bit sort of fly by the seat of their pants because people are always running around trying to create opportunity. And really, when you ask somebody, what do they need? And they say, you know, I need a break. Then all of a sudden they go in the break room and you've got people laying on the break room tables. We run a 24-hour call center. We've got ping pong tables and foosball tables all over the office. We've got couches in offices. We've got people who run out to Wawa and bring back. And so it's very much haphazard and kind of a little bit loose and crazy. And how that happened is that's how I am. And so when I talk to company owners, I'm like, your culture really has to be who you are. And then that kind of emulates through the company, but it has to be in a way that it's not about you. It's just, it makes sense.
And I agree 100% with that because I feel the same way. I feel that one of the things that I've learned over time about myself is that it's best to surround myself with people who, first of all, can balance me and run with me and deal with me and deal with my personality shifting quickly in the moment while still being individuals. Because I like to also surround myself with people who are smarter than me. You know, you and I were talking before we hit recording about IT challenges, right? And I'm like, I've been known to just take my computer and hand it over to my assistant. I can't.
Oh, absolutely.
Can't deal with it.
You know, we all have to have our gifts, our brilliance. And I don't even know how to update my iPhone. And the thing is, I don't want to know. And so part of the company culture around here is it takes a village to raise a Charlie because there's so many things I just don't want to know. I can't do. I will electrocute myself trying. And that's, I think, super important to know as well is where do you want to put in your space, in your brain? Where do you want to put your efforts? And so a lot of the time our staff, our team kind of looks at it that way. Okay, this is my brilliance. I'm going to do that. And it shines and everyone sort of allows that.
I've often used the phrase "the village" about it takes a village to deal with me.
Yeah,
and I think I was really, you know, when your assistant introduced you to us for our podcast, and I started going through your website and reading about you and your company, I instantly became. This is where the girl crush thing comes from, the business girl crush, so we're all clear about it. I was instantly attracted to you. When you talk about you being kind of the foundation of the culture, I was instantly attracted to you of how that was resonated in your marketing, on your website. It was very distinctive and very clear who you are and what your personality is. I think that's so important because you mentioned this a couple minutes ago about being inauthentic. So let's talk a little bit about that, because you are a marketing guru. Let's talk a little bit about how important it is that you're clear on your culture, but how are you communicating that to your clients and your staff?
Well, again, that's a really great question. You know, for me, it's been a journey. I'm going into my 17th year of owning Synergixx. I've been doing what I do for 20 plus years. And who I was then is certainly not who I am today. And I would say that there's been over the years a crisis of culture. And you're absolutely right. It affects the company, the staff, how we work and play together. And that absolutely affects the clients. And it's funny that you're asking this question, because I was driving home from New York yesterday with my assistant, and we walked into a meeting with a company. And at the end of the meeting, they said, "How can we work with you? Will you take us on as a client?" And as we were driving home, it was the second time this week that that's happened, where a very large company said, "Will you work with us? How do we become your client?" And so I said to my assistant, I go, "What's changed? Because that statement's happened twice this week. And are we doing something different with our marketing? Did we run an ad somewhere? Is it because I'm on the radio and TV a lot?" He goes, "No, it's none of that. It's you. They want to work with you." And I said, "But that wasn't true 3, 4, 5 years ago. I have great word of mouth, you know, reputation. We've never had a problem growing business, but it hasn't been clients saying, 'Would you allow us to be your client?' It's been clients saying, 'You know, we'd like to work with you, but let's haggle over the price. We'd like to work with you, but do it on our terms.'" And so I think part of your question is, where does that culture come from? Is that as a CEO, at one point you have to sit up and say, "It is my job and my responsibility to make sure that everyone, including customers and clients, understand what they're getting." And so in the past 2-3 years, when I show up to a meeting, I show up the way I dress. I talk the way I talk, and I'm very clear and direct with clients. If you want to work with our company, you have to do it on my terms. And my terms are this: we create excellence. We're going to treat your company like it's our company. And we know our space, and we can't afford to fail because we have a great track record. So you can't be our client unless you listen to us, because I need you to be successful, because I can't have a flaw on my books, right? And we do it with humor. We do it with a little bit of pizzazz, but it has changed just even in how people are talking about us, right? There's a voice around every company. And I think now the voice in the last 3 years at Synergixx, whether it be from vendor referrals, client referrals, people reading articles, employees talking in the space, social media, the voice of how people talk about our company changed. And that started when I decided to start talking about our company in a very intentional way.
And what do you think the shift was with that? Was it just it's one thing to be intentional, but what else did you do with that intention? Did you all of a sudden go, "You know what, I'm going to just be Charlie and this is who we are," and kind of have that shift?
You know, again, it's been a fairly long journey. I started the company when I was very young, and I started the company wearing 3-piece suits and imitating what I thought a businesswoman was supposed to do and look and act like. Even though at heart I'm a creative director, I was wearing brown suits and penny loafers and going into meetings. And you know, the title of the book, Brains, Boobs, and Balls, is you could at any point in my career put those words in different order and you'd understand where I was. And when I first started, I was more like, boobs, brains, and sometimes I brought my balls, because I didn't know, right, what the clients were buying, and I wasn't really secure. And so over the years, you know, whether it's losing clients, almost losing the business, having extreme success and growth and understanding what that means from payroll and all that, to being a mom and trying to juggle all that, at one point I just said, I can't do this anymore and be happy. I have to show up every day and honor that I've earned the right to say we do really great work and we're going to do it well, and do that with my brains. And at the same time, just not apologize the fact that I'm 5'11", I have a very large chest, I love high heels, and I can't hide any of that. And guess what? I'm still smart enough to take your company to the next level without having to apologize for the way I look. And you know what? I have the balls to tell you that my family comes first. My employees are going to take precedence over my clients. And I'm not afraid to say no and walk away, because we create opportunity and opportunity comes to us. And so once I got that straight, the order of the words in my head, and made sure that whether it was a staff meeting, a talk with my telemarketing team, or a new client, as long as I showed up that way, it changed the circle of influence around me. And so it was about, I'm going to say about 3 years ago, when I just made the decision to say, look, I'm going to walk away if it doesn't feel right. And I'm going to trust that even if that fails for me, I'll be okay. I'll figure it out. And that, you know, in prior years, the economy sucked. And I think a lot of business owners were saying yes because they were afraid of scarcity. I think a lot of business owners were doing things that didn't feel good to them, whether it was culture-wise, money-wise, client-wise, because the economy was so screwed up. Money was tight for everyone. Businesses were going under. This internet thing was getting bigger and changing the way marketing is played. So a lot of business owners just started doing things that didn't feel right. And those of us who lived through that and came out of it were exhausted. And so about 3 years ago, I just was so incredibly tired of playing that game that I sat up and I said, look, this is how I'm going to show up. And for better or worse, I'm going to tell you that my brains lead first. I can't apologize for the way I look. And at the end of the day, you can do what you're going to do, but I'm going to stay true to our company values and go forward.
I think you really hit on something with the scarcity thing with any business owner, but I think especially for women, I'm going to play the woman's card for a second because I think it's important. And I work with a lot of women entrepreneurs. There is this scarcity thing that people have to overcome to be in what I think is the abundance mindset. But how do entrepreneurs and business owners overcome those hard times financially in a business that you do, you want to quickly grab that thing because it's money and it's going to help your payroll? How do you take a stand with that?
It's a great question. It's a really hard one to answer. And, you know, if somebody's listening right now and their company's in the low point, the valley, so to speak, if they're not climbing out of the valley into the mountain, they're going to say, nobody can tell me how to get out of this financial fear I have, right? For some people, it could be, I can't grow my company because I don't have capital in the bank to do it. Other people might say, you know what, I tried to grow my company and it cost me a lot of money and I don't want to do it again. Others might say, I don't know how to do it. So you might be in business with a family member and growing your company, you know, means putting weirdness between your family. So when I coach CEOs, we really have to get to the core of what's your fear of growing, what's your fear of increasing your debt, right? I do a course on basically financing your growth through debt, and there's a way to do that. It's scary, but when you talk about how did I do it, how did other companies do it, I think that I talk a lot about this access to your resources. You know, have you taken inventory that if you fail, you make a decision and it doesn't work out, maybe that's on hiring a high-end employee, whether that's spending money on a big marketing push and it doesn't work, whether it's expanding a new location and it isn't as profitable, whatever that step is, if you do that and it doesn't work, you're going to live through it. The difference of living through it in an okay way and in a bad way is your access to resources. And that starts first with, do you have the mentorship around you where you can ask as many questions as possible before you make that leap to try to figure out where the, what I call business icebergs are. So when you get hit, you don't sink, you just get hit. And do you have access to banking relationships? Do you have access to financial forecasting that at least gives you the numbers? Do you have access to another business owner in your space that if you needed to could take on business for you or be a band-aid if it doesn't work out? So there's a whole long list that we could talk about, but it's really saying to you, like setting up what I call your access to resources. And some of those are financial, some of them are mental, spiritual. Once you do that, making risky decisions becomes a lot easier. And I give an example of the flat squirrel. And if you've seen this before, you're driving down the road and for a second you make eye contact with that squirrel in the middle of the road. And you stop, swerve, maybe you slow down altogether. And that squirrel is running left, right, in the middle, stops, goes back and forth. And at one point, you're looking out your back window with one eye shut because you want to see, is there a flat squirrel behind you? Right. And the difference is then you look up in the tree and you're like, did he get up the tree? And then you'll see that there's a squirrel up in the tree, hopefully that's not flat. The difference between flat squirrels and fat squirrels is that one made a decision at that crucial moment. And so when businesses aren't growing, and especially CEOs that aren't happy, and you can bring this into the girl route very easily, it's because we are not making decisions at the crucial moment because we're taking too long. We're overthinking them. We're avoiding the decision making. And so we get run over, and it's really difficult to recover from becoming flat. And that's the challenge for everyone, is you have to make a decision. And in order to make a decision, you need to understand that in failure, you will be fine as long as you can access the resources.
I love flat versus fat squirrels.
It's a real thing.
That is my, that's going to be a big takeaway out of this podcast. Because I've been there. I think many entrepreneurs are there with that fear, and I'm guilty of it. I take a long time to make certain decisions, and then it becomes paralysis, and then it impacts everything else you do going forward.
Well, and here's one other thing. And again, it's so easy for me to say this, right? I'm so perfect in saying this. I will tell you that it's a daily decision to think like this, but the other thing that not being decisive in business, in your love life, as a parent, is it creates noise in your head that takes away from your ability to focus on what is really important, which is growing your business, your marketing, your circle of influence. Because if you have questions in your mind, or if you're debating decisions, it actually takes up space in your head and it makes you less effective. You can't think as quickly. Right. You can't be as creative. And so sometimes, you know, not making a decision is actually worse than failing at a decision, because it now distracts you from other things.
I want to shift over to talking a little bit about attracting top talent and the importance of having a culture that attracts the best talent, but also having a culture that retains the top talent. And you had referenced, you know, the big boys, the Googles, the Zappos. Last year, I attended a Zappos culture camp to really kind of see what they do. They have a 3-day culture camp. And I've also talked to a lot of CEOs on these podcasts about employees don't necessarily, they're not necessarily caring about all the little gimmicks. That's what one of the CEOs called it, all the different gimmicks. So I'd like your perspective on the best way to attract and keep talent.
Well, the attracting talent is such a challenge. I don't speak to one business owner, one client that doesn't say, hey, how do you find good help these days?
Yeah.
So what I have in my company, and it drives my VP incredibly insane, because she is beholden, right, to payroll to sales. So she's got to keep our payroll numbers in line. But I always have an open hiring policy. And she goes, could we be more structured? Could I have a job description? Could we know what we're hiring for? Would it be too bad to have a budget? Why do we keep doing that? And I said, because every day of the week, if an awesome person walks in, we will hire them and figure the rest out. They are so rare that I'm known to go out to dinner. And if I have an amazing experience with the person serving us, the waiter, I will flat out offer them a job at dinner, because you can't really wait until the right person fills out the application or you write the right job description. It's helpful to do all that. But I think running a business is you have to look at the person serving you coffee at the Starbucks and say, hey, is that person amazing? They could just be working at Starbucks because they're finishing up their master's degree in the exact area that you're looking for. Mm-hmm. So when I look for talent, I'm looking for it not in my email where the resumes come in, not on the job hiring sites, not really through a headhunter, but we're always looking for just amazing, because I think you can make amazing people into any role you want. When you try to get people that are amazing on paper in one area, that's what you get. The other secret I have for hiring executive assistants is hire stage managers from the theater.
Ooh.
And if they're in college theater, even better, because they're so used to not making money. But stage managers in theater are actually a really interesting breed. They're trained to look at a blank stage and figure out how to fill it up. And then they're trained that when the lights go up and the show's going and something breaks, it's their responsibility to fix it before the audience notices. And they are trained to be on their knees with a hammer and fixing something and be on the phone with the PR company and getting it done. they thrive. Their brain is all about how do I anticipate problems and how do I make the show look flawless. And when I found my current executive assistant who came from that space, I've never looked better. When I hired assistants that looked like people that wanted to be me, right? They wanted to be a CEO or they wanted to be a top marketing person. When you hire in your own image, I didn't have that experience. So those would be two things that I would say is really where are you finding your talent? It should be the people that make you feel amazing outside of your office. Mm. And then when you're really looking for that high-end person is look at the other industries that have skill sets that are similar to what you want and bring them in and train them on your company as opposed to always saying, I'm hiring for a marketing assistant, so let me put an ad out for a marketing assistant and get in hundreds of resumes from marketing assistants of other ad agencies. Mm-hmm. It's not bringing a new skill set to me. And so I think that's a little bit counterintuitive to hire from outside of your industry. But it really does bring a fresh perspective to everything.
And then what about retention and keeping people? You know, we get a lot of clients asking us the same question: how do we can't find good talent? How do we get that? But also in the retention part, we get a lot of questions around, especially millennials, that they're stereotyped for jumping jobs after a couple years.
Don't get me going on millennials. They are a challenge. We have to. We have to deal with them. They're some of the brightest people you ever meet. Mm-hmm. I would say this about millennials. It's not really their fault.
Right.
They are brilliant. They've done a lot of stuff. I would, if you're speaking specifically about millennials, here's what I've noticed because we've hired a lot of them. In fact, my executive assistant now is a millennial. The difference between him and the other ones is the age of his parents. Were they raised by baby boomers or were they raised by a younger set of parents? And what I found is the ones that are raised by baby boomers are actually not really, they don't have that same millennial mindset that sort of, I want to jump around. But the question about retention is interesting. When I sit and I hire somebody and I work with somebody, I tell them right up front, you can't be here in the same role for more than 18 months. That's not the kind of company that we have. Hmm. I need you to excel in this company. I don't know where that's going to be. There's no ceiling here. I need you to find your area where you make the company amazing and you're rewarded for that. And so right up front, I then say to them, and when it's time, I'm going to introduce you to your next boss. I want you to succeed because if you're succeeding, if everyone's knocking on the door to hire you, that means you're doing an amazing job in our company and our clients. And so part of the retention is, like I said, we have this sort of open culture here where we're really family first. What do you need to make your life good? Whether that's taking a day off and working from home, whether that's having an office by a window because that's your deal, taking coffee breaks whenever you want. We're very much about what do you need to get your job done to service the client? What do you need personally? And then more importantly, how are you creating opportunity? And so I've been very lucky. My first employee is still with me. She started as a copywriter. She now runs the entire agency. My core staff has been with me 7 to 8 years. And I think that's a testament to putting the onus on them to find their own greatness in the company. And then I'm also super excited about the opportunities that we've created for some of our best talent. Three of some of my favorite employees that I ever had, I personally got them hired somewhere else because they had reached a place in our company where they weren't going to keep going up. And I don't mean in pay. I mean in feeling good about their position right. and getting more experience and owning it. And so I made calls in my network and I said, I have an amazing employee and I think they could go and rock your company. And they said, oh, okay. Are you trying to fire them? I said, no, but I'd love for you to offer them an opportunity. And the first two times I did that, the employees came to me and they said, I've never been fired by getting my boss to hire me somewhere else. And I'm like, great. I didn't fire you, but I am asking you to go and develop greater. And so they send people our way. I think there's also, when you go back to the scarcity mindset, there's a fear that your employees will get too good. There's a fear that your employees will one day try to become your competition, or that if you hire too much of an expensive employee, they're going to keep wanting more and more. It goes back to my concept of you can do anything with amazing people. They have to be amazing body, mind, and soul. but you can't also want them there forever. They have to be able to leave.
That really gave me a flashback to early on in my career. I had a boss just like that in Chicago at the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce. She was the director of communications and I worked under her in PR, and she did the same exact thing. She found me my next job. I was sort of, at first I was a little put off. I'm like, why is she trying to get rid of me? But she was really, that was how she operated. She got me into my next position because it paid more and had better opportunities. And then she continued through my career, and she used to call me cannoli because I'm Italian. She would call me and say, cannoli. And she was this tough Irish broad. Like my interview with her at lunch, she required me to drink alcohol with her. That's like the core of who she was. Cannoli, I got another job opportunity for you, cannoli. And she was constantly doing that. And I think so young to have a mentor like that really shaped who I became. And I think it's important to be a really good leader and mentor to help produce future mentors and leaders, because I now am like exactly like her and like always trying to connect people, always trying to find other people opportunities authentically without any wanting anything back in return. So kudos to you. That's a great culture to be in at your organization.
Well, and I don't want to sound like we've got it all figured out. I think we're always growing and changing and blending. And somebody asked me the other day, they said, what have you learned lately? And my answer came out so incredibly fast that it shocked me. I said, I learned that I am a hot mess recently. And I had this moment of clarity because we're going through this really great growth period in our company. We've just emerged with another company. We're offering different services. We've gone through some hiring. We're going into a really great growth year. And there's all sorts of great stuff happening. And my kids are growing and I'm on a book tour and all this great, great stuff is happening. And I got home the other day from dropping my kid off at school in the morning, and he goes to school really early, and I have to sometimes get up at 5:30 and then go drop him off, and it's an hour. And to be honest, sometimes I just throw on the dingy bathrobe, get in the car, drop him off, come home. And I did that, and I walked in the kitchen, and my husband just happened to be in the kitchen, and he looked at me, and all he said was, "So, I see you were shopping at Walmart." And I was like, oh my, I know exactly what you're talking about. It's those pictures that you see online of the Walmart and they're making fun of them. Yeah. And I looked down and I didn't even have pants on underneath the robe and my hair was crazy. There was a time when I first met my husband, like for the first decade of our relationship, where he never saw me without makeup. I would get up early, go to the bathroom, put on a perfect face, and then go back and lay in bed and make my hair perfect on the pillow. So when he woke up, I was perfect. And I'm in the kitchen with no pants on and a dirty bathrobe with some crazy hair. And all he could say was, oh, you were at Walmart. It was such a moment of realization. And I didn't have time to digest it because my assistant was there to take me to New York for an interview. And he walked in. He said, are you wearing a bathrobe for the interview? We have to leave. And so I'm being driven to New York and I'm trying to do a conference call. And I look in and I said, I don't even have makeup on. He goes, I was going to bring that up. And we get to the interview. And he said, where's your clothes? I go, what are you talking about? He goes, you said you were going to change in the car. I said, I am. He said, where's your clothes? I forgot them on the kitchen table.
Oh my gosh.
I have 2 hours from New York, right? So it's just been this really incredible, crazy ride. And what I had to acknowledge, I literally sent my team a text, right? A team text. And I said, I'm going to apologize for today right now. I'm not functioning that well. I hope you guys can keep up. Not one person said anything other than got it. And it was, they walked in, somebody handed me coffee, somebody over here, they're like, we canceled this call. So I think part of the culture thing is that, and it comes back to that question of authenticity. Mm-hmm. I've spent so many years feeling fraudulent and feeling afraid of failure that I would bring that into the business and I would hide things from employees. I would not say certain things to vendors because I didn't want to be discovered. That I really didn't know what I was doing or that I was, you know, stressing about the growth or whatnot. And they pick up on it. And so now I would be inauthentic to come into work every day and say, hey, I got 9 hours of sleep last night. And isn't the world pretty? And look, we're growing and the birds are chirping. You know, it's like, this is me when we're growing this company this fast and this furious. And I hope you guys are in for the ride, because they have to understand that I'm challenging myself as much as I'm challenging them, because otherwise it just feels like they're workhorses. And it also has to feel like a team birthing exercise to an extent. So I fell too far with the hot mess. I immediately went and got my hair blow dried to fix the situation.
Thank you for being so authentic and transparent with that story, because I think it's a great example. I think we all go through that as entrepreneurs, and I relate to it so much. I struggle between the being, you know, politically correct. And I think I've experienced some of that growth in the past couple of years. I've had team members say, you know, you shouldn't have put that on Facebook. That comment you made. And I'm like, why? Well, what if our clients see it? I'm like, you know, this is, you know, if people don't like me for me, well, then they probably shouldn't work with me.
You know, you're going to be discovered. And this is, it's hard to understand that. Like, if there's something wrong with you, you might want to go and get it fixed, because it'll be discovered. But if it's not wrong, if it's just you and it's part of the package that your brilliance comes in, it will be discovered. Your clients will find out, your customers will find out. And so it's about constantly improving on what you can, and just owning who you are and always delivering, right? And if you deliver on what you say you're going to do, whether it's from the company standpoint, client or customer, if you deliver, you get a lot of breaks for how it's delivered, right? Mm-hmm. You can be a little bit of a hot mess as long as the results are there, the intention is there.
So you mentioned being going through some growth and acquiring another company. Do you have any advice around that for other companies going through a high, fast growth process that may also be acquiring other companies, and what's your plan around merging those cultures?
So those are two questions, and I will answer the first one. It's going to sound flippant, but it's exactly how I do it. When we go through any big change or growth, or I have to like pull up my big girl panties and say, okay, we're about to spend $500,000 to do this, or we have to grow again. And I get that fear and that tightness in my chest going, is this the right deal? I do two things. Quite honestly, I make sure I'm having an orgasm every day, and I make sure that I have an Excel spreadsheet that is fully filled out. I live on Excel spreadsheets because I use them as a way to tell a story. The story could be, what happens if this decision is failure? What happens if I get in over my head? And I tell that story in Excel, because Excel has no emotions. And the Excel just looks you back and says, look, if you don't do X by this date, you're going to be in the hole, and this is how much money you're going to lose. Or Excel says, look, it's great, it's happy, you're going to grow, but you're only going to make this much percentage of profit. Excel is also a really great tool that when you're talking to outside mentors about making a big leap, whether it's a bank, a financial advisor, your board of directors, an investor, your husband, whomever, Excel is a universal language. And if you can convince people on that paper, starting with yourself, that you've clearly thought this out, risks and rewards, they can see it. They don't need to hear your emotional plea to convince them. They don't need to hear your bad salesman job to do it. You've done it on an Excel spreadsheet. Creating those Excel spreadsheets, though, you have to do it from a really positive place. And I will tell you that if you are so incredibly busy growing your business and you can't have an orgasm every day, then you're not in a positive place. Like, you have to have this self-care. And for women especially, I know it sounds crazy, but women especially don't orgasm enough, and it changes the chemicals that hit their brain, and they don't think the same way. And I've spoken to many female CEOs that say, I don't have time for that. I'm running a company. Well, how good of a company are you running if you don't have time to take care of you first? Mm-hmm. And so when I go to make a big decision, it's really that. It's orgasms and Excel spreadsheets. But your second question was, how am I going to merge the cultures of the company that we're bringing in? And it couldn't be more of a ready question. Our company cultures are so incredibly different that the CEO of that company who's coming into this one, he and I have spent hours behind closed doors deconstructing our lead employees, deconstructing what systems are super important to him in culture in his company, and which ones are, you know, deal breakers in my company, and how do we merge that, and how do we look at our two personalities? It's like, how do we become really great leaders without giving up what we've made great individually? And so it's a lot of discussions and talking, and we break out, we have really quick team meetings and get their feedback. So it's a huge challenge.
But the fact that you sit down and talk about it, I think a lot of companies avoid that discussion. They go through a merger, and they're looking at the financial, they're looking at the spreadsheet, but they're not really thinking ahead about, let's at least have a conversation around this.
Well, you know, the analogy I give is, imagine if the Brady Bunch, the parents in the Brady Bunch, had merged their families and not had a discussion about it first. Like, that's a crazy family to blend together, right? They had to have sat down and said, are the three girls going to share a room, and are they going to feel crowded, and the three boys here, and do we get the housekeeper or the dog? And that had to have been a very big conversation, very similar to if you're going to, you know, get married again and merge families, merge friends, whatever it is. It is so incredibly important to have those conversations. And just like you would do anything, what happens if our cultures just don't blend? If our team doesn't blend, we can't force it. What's our backup plan?
Yeah.
And, you know, part of the challenge that we're having right now, and this is going to sound kind of counterintuitive, but our respective teams are so incredibly excited to be working together that every day they walk in the office with a new damn idea, and they need to hire this person, and they want this, and can we go over here, and can we spend more time? And we're like, wait a minute, could you run the company? Could you stop coming up with ideas? They're super excited. All of a sudden, I took my partner aside and I said, we're going to go broke. They want to do all this stuff, and they all like each other, and it sucks. We have to create some tension in the company. He goes, no, I don't think that's the right idea. I'm like, no, immediately, let's go create drama. And so we're arguing that. He's like kind of anti-drama. I really feel like there needs to be a fight. But when your company gets out of your own control, it's also can be really scary as a business owner. And that's kind of where I'm at. We're in a very, very big, exciting time of growth with two very big personalities coming in to merge. And our employees are so incredibly excited that I'm afraid they're going to wake up one day and go, well, that was short-lived. This ain't that great. Charlie's not all that exciting. This, you know, and then the fall from grace is going to be so fast and furious. So I'm working on ways to just temper everyone and just to say, look, it's business as usual. So we'll see.
I have a feeling it's going to work out just fine. I do.
Well, I will let you know.
I'll check in with you. I want to, for a second, talk about your book, because that was the thing that popped out at me, and you referenced that you're on a book tour. And the question that really jumped out for me around that, as I'm working on a book this year, is your balls to have the balls to have a book title with the word balls in it. Can you talk a little bit around that? And it goes back to like the whole authentic thing and really being the authentic person you are, to not really be concerned of the people who are going to say, I don't think that's a good idea.
A lot of people said that. My mother-in-law was appalled in many ways that I did that. And it wasn't an easy choice. The quick story behind the book is it never was supposed to be what it is. When I started 2 years ago on it, I was writing a business book to generate customers for Synergixx. Mm-hmm. I was writing a book for small business entrepreneurs, small to mid-sized companies, to say, hey, here's how you launch a product or idea, and here's how you get confident enough to get to the next level, right? So the idea being, if I can teach my customers tricks to grow their own business, then they're going to spend more money with me. So it was a really intentional book, and I had a publisher, and I would submit chapters, and they say, you really need to put more of you in the book. I said, I don't want to talk about me. I want to talk about spreadsheets and banking relationships and quantum media. And I want to talk about, when do you take capital? And they said, no, well, you need to earn their respect, and you need to put more of your journey in there. And so I did. And then they had 40 different focus groups that I attended, and I would do these manuscript readings. And after it was over, almost every meeting, the questions I was getting was about the life around the business, not the business. It was how, you know, I'm raising a family now. I'm not going to start a business until my kids are out of my house. How do you have a happy marriage and do this? Because when I work, my husband's jealous of my time. My wife is so not part of our relationship when she's growing her business. I don't want her to grow her business. I don't feel comfortable growing. I feel like I don't have a voice in the world. I'm in a man's industry. Like, all of the questions I was getting had nothing to do with business. It had to do with what I call the life around the business. And so we reshaped a lot of the chapters. And then the publisher said, hey, we want you to write a sex book for entrepreneurial women. And I said, well, okay, but I don't know. That's not what I do. Like, I'm not a sex coach, and that's not going to get me infomercial clients for my company or authors. What? So the publisher and I went round and round, and there's the chapters in my book. There's the three opening chapters were brains, boobs, and balls were the titles. And it's how I break down intelligence and physicality, because I believe that's a huge part of being successful, and really where you get the guts to make decisions. And that's the first three chapters. And they came to me and they said, we want that to be the title of your book, and we want you to write a sex book for female entrepreneurs. It'll be a big hit. And we went round and around, and I said, I'm not writing that. That's not who I am, and it's not going to attract clients to the business. And so I actually broke up with the publisher. I broke my contract with them, and I got into a co-publishing agreement. They allowed me to take the name, and I wasn't going to use it. And as we started to name the book and take what we learned in the focus groups, the book itself took on a much different shape. And we did all these book titles. And at one point, somebody said, nothing that you're coming up with embodies what you talk about in the book. And they finally said, we really think that, you know, brains, boobs, and balls will work. So I had to make a conscious choice to say, hey, that's going to kind of affect my brand a little bit. But then what happened is the week it was released in July, we were slated to make the Wall Street Journal bestseller list for that week. And we were right in number 4 or 5 based on sales. We sold an extreme amount in that 1 week. And the co-publisher called up, the book marketers called up, and they said, hey, we haven't seen these numbers in a while. You're definitely making the list. And it was going to be released on a Thursday. And then I was taken off the list. And everyone below me was moved up. And the reason was the title was too racy. And I didn't realize this, how naive, that really bestseller lists are arbitrary. They can take you off for whatever reason they want. Huh. And they said it was too racy. And I thought, well, which word is too racy? Is it the boobs, balls? Is it the order? Is it because I didn't use a comma? So, you know, when you think things like 50 Shades of Grey were on the bestseller list, and that's porn between two covers, and, you know, the one that Jennifer Garner talks about that, you know, shut the F up, that made the list. How is it possible that this one? And they said, well, they didn't spell the words out. I'm like, okay. So I said, well, I never expected to sell that many books anyway, so that's nice. Who cares? And my co-publisher said, no. We want you to re-release it under a new title. Can you come up with a new title? And I said, what? Like the Beatles used to do when they put an album out with a toilet on it and they didn't like it, so they put a new sticker. And he goes, yeah, like that. And so in 4 days, I came up with a new title of the book, and I wrote an intro chapter explaining what had happened, and I turned it into a marketing lesson. And the book was re-released under the title A New Breed of Shark. And both titles are available. Both are selling. Brains, Boobs, and Balls outsells the second book by at least 2 to 1. And what we have found that's so interesting is when I speak at universities, at business colleges, they will not allow me to talk about Brains, Boobs, and Balls. They only want a new breed of shark. When I go on certain media, they only will let me talk about the quote unquote safe coffee title book. When I go and talk to business owners, they only want to talk about Brains, Boobs, and Balls. They're the exact same book, except a chapter and a cover difference.
Wow.
And so so that's been a really interesting, crazy kind of journey. And what the book is, I was actually just this week, I got a handwritten letter from a girl in college, and she was reading it, and she took time out, and she said to me, I'm only on chapter 3, and I had to write to you. And I won't go into the whole letter, but all she said was, I wanted to say thank you for helping me see that what I'm doing right now is the right thing for me and not anybody else.
Wow.
And it was incredibly profound for me, because when people say, well, who should be reading your book and what do people get out of it and all that, it's been something different for everyone. But I think what she just said for me was, if that's all people get out of it, whether they're struggling in business, whether they're struggling in their personal life, or they're struggling that they want to change careers or even decide if they want to be a business owner, it's just understanding that what you're doing right now is right for you and not anybody else, and creating your own journey.
Thank you for sharing that story. What a great story. Because I saw, you know, I ordered your book, and I gravitated to the boobs and balls and brains. but I saw the shark title on Amazon, and I'm like, oh, what's that book? But I didn't bother clicking on it to read about it.
Yeah. And we've had that, and there's a marketing twist. So when I talk with clients and they say, oh, we've been marketing this product and it didn't work. And I'm like, well, did you consider what you're calling it? Yeah. And so there is a marketing lesson in there, and there's a reason there that would be like that. But the other thing I will tell you, and this is going into market research, for example, I was at a blow dry bar in New York just yesterday getting my hair done so nobody thought I was from Walmart. And I sit down and the woman's like, well, where are you going? I said, I have to be on this TV show and I just need my hair done really quick. She goes, why? And I said, oh, I'm on this book tour. And she said, really, what's the book? And I said, oh, Brains, Boobs, and Balls. She goes, no way. I downloaded that from Google Play. And I went, I don't have an audio book. Is it audio book? And she just looked at me. She goes, you don't know what Google Play is? I'm like, I don't. And then I was like, I never met anybody I didn't know that did that. And she said, yeah. I said, oh, well, I'm flattered. Did you like it? And she goes, no. I'm like, okay. And then she goes, well, you know, it was funny, but I didn't, it just wasn't for me. And I said, well, oh, do you mind me asking why? And she said, oh, yeah. She's like, well, I didn't want to go into business. I was just looking for a book to, you know, get me out of my funk. And I just looked at the title and I downloaded it. But like, I would never start my own business. And you did all this talking about business. So I didn't like that part very much. But there were some funny parts. I'm like, all right. And then I literally had to look up Google Play. I didn't even know you could download a book on Google Play.
Oh my gosh, that's funny.
You know, it's really, it is a business book at the end of the day, but it's told from a perspective of, you know, I tell people, I'm like, well, I'll let you look under my sheets because I screwed everything up for 15 years. And if you can learn from one of my screw-ups and that helps you feel better about your screw-ups, then, you know, we're partners in crime.
Oh, that's great. Mine arrived yesterday, so I'm going to go through it over the weekend. I was hoping to read it before I talk to you, but you will continue to linger on with me after this podcast.
Oh, good. Thank you.
One last question, and I know I've kept you longer than I should, but it's the question I ask everybody at the end of the podcast. So I feel like people will feel cheated if I don't ask it. And the same question I ask every guest, and it is, what is your spirit animal or totem animal? Like, what animal would you be in business?
Well, I would assume it would be a good idea if I said a shark just for selling book purposes, but I'm really not a shark in any way, shape, or form. My spirit animal, it's certainly not a squirrel. And I think I'm probably somewhere between a mermaid and a unicorn.
Oh, I love that. Why?
Yeah. Because they're very glamorous and shiny creatures, and I love to dress up and wear high heels, and I like glittery stuff. There is actually no evidence in the world that they are not real.
Ooh.
And I think that is a very cool spirit animal to be, because nobody's proven that they're extinct like the dinosaurs, and nobody's proven that they don't exist. We just haven't seen them yet.
That is the best answer ever. That's awesome.
Oh,
I love that. You. And you are the first, and probably, I'm guessing, will be the only mermaid/unicorn that we will have on this podcast. So that's
perfect.
That's great. If people want to connect with you, and I wrote this down, I'm sure people will be interested in the course that you talked about, financing your growth through debt. If people want to connect with you or learn more about that or learn more about your book or your company, what are the best ways to do that?
Well, I'm all over social media, just at Charlie Fusco. If you go to thatgirlcharlie.com, you can connect with me personally, or you can connect with my business. I haven't been there in a while, and I think the book is on there, but I will have to ask one of my assistants because that falls into technology. But I know that you can find me there. And, but I'm all over Facebook and LinkedIn and Instagram, but That Girl Charlie has all of those connections.
Great. And I guess if anyone is following me at Gina Trimarco, you'll see the tweet that I tweeted to Charlie. You could find her that way too, where I said I have a girl crush on her, girl business crush. Thank you so much for taking the time. I know you're really busy and a hot mess and all that, but thank you for taking the time to be on this podcast today.
Absolutely. I really appreciate the opportunity and really respect what you're doing and trying to be a thought leader in the world and really help entrepreneurs be game changers, because I think that's what we're doing. Entrepreneurs really are the people out there that are changing the world and creating opportunity, and they need as much help as anybody. And so I really respect what you're doing with your podcast and how you're really trying to make people remember that the company culture is as important as the company.
Thank you. Okay, well, we're gonna wrap it up. We're going to say goodbye to Charlie. So thank you, everybody, for listening today. You can find show notes on for this episode, including contact information for Charlie. I'll put all that on there. And you'll find that at thepivotalleader.com. The Pivotal Leader is a production of Pivot 10 Results, a strategy and training company that helps businesses shift from people problems to performance results. And remember, you can find our podcast on iTunes. And if you're an iTunes subscriber, please leave a rating and a review. And don't forget to email me your questions about employee engagement and customer acquisition at gina@pivot10.com. And until next time, if you're feeling stuck in your business, it's probably time to pivot. You've been listening to The Pivotal Leader. To learn more about how to shift your culture and pivot to success, visit pivot10results.com. That's pivot10results.com.